Blackstone Audio presents The Vulture, an Ike Schwartz mystery by Frederick Ramsay. This book is read by Lloyd James. Forward. Some time ago, I took my car in for some routine maintenance, probably an oil change. I was called to the desk to pay my bill and pick up my keys, and although it seemed they were the keys that had been used to drive the car to the ready line, I realized that they were not mine. I said so. The clerk smiled and said politely, yes, they were, that those keys were the ones used to bring my car to the pickup point. I looked over his shoulder and saw my keys hanging on a pegboard behind him. I had put an attachment which was quite distinctive on the ring, and the keys hanging had it. We argued, and finally, with an indulge the customer look on his face, the supervisor, for that was the level we had reached by then, marched me out to my car. I inserted my key in the ignition and started the car. Next, and to the supervisor's chagrin, I inserted the other set and started the car again. I have no way to calculate the odds that two nearly identical cars would be at the same location on the same day and both keyed alike. It boggles the mind. Yet sometime later, when I told this story at a meeting, one of the participants reported that the same thing had happened to her. So the odds must not be as great as one might think. They say that truth is stranger than fiction. Perhaps. But stranger not. Truth certainly does suggest some really strange fiction. Listen on. Pursuant Executive Order Number 10834, August 21, 1959, President Eisenhower established the official flag of the United States as a banner with 50 stars. This flag was raised for the first time at 12:01 a.m. on July 4, 1960, at the Fort McHenry National Monument in Baltimore, Maryland, and is currently the official flag of the United States of America. Chapter 1. Smoldering flames and a streetlight leaning at an acute angle and flashing on and off like a badly programmed strobe, and firemen's work lights illuminating the street bright as day. Frank Sutherland's head spun. In spite of the glare, he sensed only darkness. Nauseated and short of breath, he felt his knees start to buckle. Darkness comes. In the middle of it, the future looks blank. The temptation to quit is huge. Frank read that somewhere. He couldn't remember who wrote it. Piper? Somebody, Piper. It seemed eerily strange, remembering that line just now, but also appropriate. He was tempted to cut and run, to get as far away from this place as possible. He took a deep breath, steadied, and forced himself to focus on the awful truth that the otherwise unrecognizable, charred body behind the wheel, in what was left of the twisted and scorched Buick, must be all that remained of Ike Schwartz. The car's trunk had sprung open from the blast. He studied what was left of its familiar contents and the blistered and twisted, just readable license plate dangling from the bumper. Ike had used his own car again. He was funny that way. Frank pivoted on his heel. His gaze took in everything, the glass shards from broken store windows, twisted bits and pieces of automobile, and still smoking chunks of what might have been upholstery or, he didn't want to think, or what, scattered over a quarter of an acre of downtown Picketsville, Virginia. It had to have been one hell of a bomb. The volunteer fire department had arrived almost as quickly as he had and made sure that the fire did not spread. Some of its members, still booted and helmeted, stood by keeping watch on the smoldering wreckage while the rest were busy rolling up hoses and storing equipment. A low haze, part steam, part smoke from burning upholstery and gasoline, drifted over the area. Those who spoke did so in hushed voices. EMTs, seeing that their medical skills would not be needed and having been assured that the vehicle had cooled sufficiently, donned gloves and began the grisly task of removing the body and placing it in a body bag and thence onto a gurney to be taken to the morgue for autopsy. What they expected the medical examiner to find was anyone's guess. Frank's head swam. Ike Schwartz. Dead. He had a hard time getting his mind around that. Sure, Ike had enemies. What cop doesn't? And Ike had served time in the agency. There could be some bad stuff left over from that, but this was Picketsville, Virginia. What were the chances? He took one last look at the scene, turned, and went back to his cruiser to think. To plan. Who would tell Ruth? Frank assumed that, as second in line and now acting sheriff, it fell to him to make the call to Ike's wife. Once he'd done that, he'd call everyone in. All shifts, part-timers and retired. They would mount a task force, the likes of which had never been seen anywhere. Vacations off, leaves canceled. He wanted everybody on this for as long as it took. He'd ask Carl Hedrick to call in some favors from the FBI, that is, if he had any left to call in. And Sam. He'd ask Sam to jump on the internet. If there was anything lurking out there in cyberspace, she'd surer than hell would find it. Whoever had done this was about to find out they'd made the worst mistake of their life. The phone's insistent ringing woke Ruth. At night, she made a point of disconnecting the answering machine on the assumption that any call made after midnight would likely be an emergency and needed her attention.
Okay, in a minute.
She fumbled for the phone and picked up at the same time as her mother. Hello? They said in unison.
Hang up, Mother, I've got it. How do you know it's not for me?
What are the chances? I'll holler if it is. Now go back to bed. Ruth waited for the click that indicated the line was clear.
Hello? Who's this?
She listened. Her expression changed from sleepy annoyance to concern to fear.
You're sure? Oh, God, you can't be. Tonight? Where? Yes. I understand. I will. What? When? 3 days from now. I don't know. People will be all over the place. How will I... Where? Will you be able to do that? He will? You're sure? How do I reach you? Okay, yes. Yes. I still don't understand. Okay, I will. I promise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.